We'll be in John chapter 13. Good morning. So good to be with you guys. Any morning people in the house? Yeah. All right. So y'all got to get everybody else going. Glad y'all are here. John chapter 13. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments, taking a towel, tied it around his waist, then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" And Jesus answered, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand." This is the word of the Lord. And Father God, we thank you for this word that you've given us today. I pray that you would prepare the hearts of your people, speak to them. You know what they need. You know what they've gone through over the last 12 months since we last convened for a general assembly. So I pray that you would grab their hands and walk with them this morning. Father God, I pray that you would move me out of the way. I pray that I would decrease and that you would increase and be made much of in the lives of your people. It's in your matchless son's Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. In his book, Leaders Eat Last, Simon Sinek talks about his curiosity about the U.S. Marine Corps. He was so curious about the culture of the U.S. Marine Corps. They were so selfless and so humble and so willing to sacrifice. He was curious about this culture. So one day he got the chance to ask the question. He was sitting down for lunch with a retired Marine Corps general. So he asked this general, "What makes the U.S. Marine Corps so different?" And that general gave him a simple but profound answer. He said, "What makes the Marine Corps so different is that our officers eat last." Our officers eat last. Those with the highest rank, those who are the most visible and upfront, the leaders of the thing, they eat last. And then those who are entrusted to them know that they can trust these leaders because they have put themselves last and they have chosen to love and care for and protect and guard those entrusted to them. That selflessness cultivates and breeds more selflessness. Leaders eat last. There's a horrifying yet inspiring picture of this I'd like to show you. This is an example of a leader eating last. This is a mother in Nairobi, Kenya in 2013, in the middle of a mass shooting at a mall. She covers her children with her body as to say, "Not them. Me. If anybody's gonna go, it's gonna be me." And they sit there in that position. She's using all of the resources that she has. And they lay in that position for 4 hours, pretending to be shot. And 65 people were shot that day. But that mother used the resources that she had to cover her children. That's what leadership looks like. That's the image of the shepherd that Jesus gives us in the book of John. The shepherd doesn't disappear when the enemy comes. That's what the hired hands do. But the shepherd puts himself in front of the enemy, in front of the threat. Leaders eat last. This is an inspiring kind of leadership. But unfortunately, what makes the headlines, what sells articles, what gets hits on social media is this idea of selfish leaders. We tend to hear more about leaders who eat first and save all of the leftovers for themselves, and this does not inspire us. As a matter of fact, it scares us. It breaks our hearts when we hear about injustices, when someone that we believed in and looked up to lets us down. Do we need another documentary about another failed leader? This type of leadership does not inspire. As a matter of fact, selfishness cultivates more selfishness. And as a fellow pastor, you begin to wonder, is anybody in this for the right reasons anymore? You can become jaded. You can become suspicious of others, wondering if anybody is really still in this thing for Jesus, because what tends to make the headlines is this idea that maybe leaders eat first and are not so selfless after all. Then this causes us to guard ourselves. This causes us to protect ourselves because, hey man, maybe other people aren't in this for the right reason after all. And some of you guys have been in ministry for a long time. You've been in ministry long enough to be hurt. You've been hurt by staff. You've been hurt by congregants. You've been in this long enough to get a few bruises. You've got some nasty emails and letters, and it can be tempting to just guard yourself and hide. And it can be tempting to come to an assembly like this and feel like you have to be 10 feet tall and bulletproof. How's everything going back at the church? Everything is going perfect. Everything is up and to the right. I'm not opening it up. I'm not sharing what's really going on. And brother or sister, you cannot recharge if you don't open up and allow yourself to be recharged. I want to encourage you this week to open up, to be vulnerable, to let someone in, and to know that though there is a lot of brokenness around you and selfishness begets more selfishness, we are privileged to serve a selfless king, and that king is named Jesus. That's the king that you were created to follow. And you don't want to have to guard yourself and cover yourself. You want to be known and loved because that's what you were created for. You were created to follow a selfless king and to be part of an unshakable kingdom. You want to be known and loved. And we find that person in the person of Jesus. As we come to our text in John 13, we see an angry mob in the search of a criminal named Jesus. And as he awaits this mob in Gethsemane, Jesus says, "Not the others, take me." This is the kind of king that we long to follow. This is the type of leader that we long to follow. Though sin and death and the devil had his arrows pointed at each of us, Jesus, our selfless king, says, "Not them, take me." As the wrath of God was to be poured out onto the sins of humanity, Jesus said, "Not them, take me." Let's look at our text. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. That's good news. One point to take away from this passage is that he loved these people. He loved them. They just weren't followers. We live in a day where it's cool to accumulate followers, to build a following, to get fans, to get likes. These weren't just names on the membership roll or faces in the crowd. There was no subscription to pay at the end, no gotcha moment at the end. No, he loved them. No bait and switch. His heart was pure. He loved them to the end. All that he had poured out. And friends, he loves you too. He offers a physical demonstration of his love and his service to his disciples by the washing of their feet. Verse 4, so he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing and wrapped a towel around his waist. And after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet. He began to wash their feet. He got the towel and he got the basin and he began to wash their feet. This was common in that day. They walked around wearing sandals. Your feet can get a little rough, a little dusty walking around in that time period. And so most of the time, someone would have a servant who would wash their guest's feet. And if there was no servant available, then no one's feet would get washed. But King Jesus humbled himself. It was not beneath him to grab the towel and to grab the basin and to wash his disciples' feet. He loved them. He loved these men. He loves you too. Because this was unusual, it made some of them uncomfortable with this idea of getting their feet washed by Jesus. So one of the disciples spoke up. It's the one that always speaks up, old Peter, speaking up again. Verse 6, he says, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, you do not realize what I'm doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you will have no part with me. What Peter and the other disciples didn't know at the time, but you theologians know it today, that foot washing was a foreshadowing of an even greater act of service. It was a moving picture of an even deeper cleansing. Jesus' death on the cross serves as the ultimate act of service and the ultimate cleansing, as his blood cleanses us of our sins. And this is what Jesus is trying to get Peter to understand. If we are not cleansed by King Jesus, then we will have no place in his kingdom. So Peter replies with a little bit of humor. He says, then Lord, Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, but my hands and my head also. See, Jesus is an unusual character in history. A servant king is an unusual archetype. It's not uncommon to see kings and rulers and government officials sending out people to fight on their behalf. The script usually goes like this: I'm the king, you're the soldier, so you fight for me. You die for me. You go on the battlefield for me. But Jesus flips the script. He says, no, I will fight for you. I will bleed for you. I will die for you. That's the kind of selfless king that we follow. Unusual behavior for a king. But isn't that the kind of king that you want to follow? Isn't that the kind of king that you want to serve? Isn't that the kind of kingdom that you want to be a part of? Simon Sinek was amazed at the humble service found inside of the U.S. Marine Corps. Why are they so humble? Why are they so selfless? Well, because the officers eat last, the leaders eat last. What if people looked at God's church and had the same reaction? To get specific, what if people looked at the EPC and had the same reaction? What would we say? What makes the EPC so different? What would we say? Would we bring up our theology? Will we bring up our polity? Not bad things, of course. I'm not trying to get in trouble here. But imagine if we could say this: we wash each other's feet. We serve each other. We love each other because we follow a king who first loved us. And we might not vote the same, and we might not look the same, but we are children of the same Father in heaven, and we are family to the end, my friend. That is a witness that the world is dying for, desperate for. John 13, 12 through 7. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I've done for you? He asked him. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who has sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. What makes the EPC so different? We want to say, we ought to say, we wash each other's feet. We are not above that. We never grow out of giving humble service. And this might not necessarily look like foot washing, but no job is too big and no job is too small. No person is unworthy of receiving honor. That's why this week at GA, these volunteers are serving you the way that you are. We want you to feel seen. We want you to feel known. And we want you to feel loved like the child of the King that you are. Whether it's a brother or a sister who has been serving for 60 years or 60 minutes, they deserve honor. It doesn't matter if you have a church of 15,000 or 15. We as followers of the humble servant King Jesus Christ from Nazareth wash each other's feet. And sadly, we live in a celebrity culture that has trained us to wash the person's feet who has the church of 15,000 while overlooking the person's feet who has the church of 15. But may it not be so among us. Oh, what makes the EPC so different? We want to be able to say we wash each other's feet. And just because I disagree with you does not mean that I have to dishonor you. And just because you disagree with me doesn't mean that you have to dishonor me. What do we say around here? We say in essentials, unity, in the non-essentials, liberty, in all things. All right. If Jesus can wash feet and serve his fellow brethren, so can we. Oh, what makes the EPC so different? We want to say, we ought to say, we wash each other's feet. And some of us are like Peter. We don't know if we want to get our feet washed. We don't know if we want to reveal the true condition of our feet. We don't know if we want to get that vulnerable. But for us to wash your feet, brother, for us to wash your feet, sister, we have to be able to see your feet. And after the past few years, some of our feet might be in some bad shape. You've been running hard and you've been walking long. You might even have a wicked smell coming off of them feet. But little do you know, you're not the only brother or the only sister hurting, and your feet ain't the only one who stink. What makes the EPC so different? We want to be able to say, we ought to be able to say, we wash each other's feet. So what does this look like practically for us? This week, some of us are called to primarily be a foot washer. Though we're called to be both, but God might be calling you to be a foot washer this week. Some of you might be called to be a foot washy. Now, that's not in the Greek. You won't find foot washy in the Greek. But some of you are called to let someone serve you this week. Some of us are called to be foot washers, and some of us are called to be foot washies, and probably a little bit of both. The foot washers. God is calling some of you to encourage a weary brother or sister. And just listen. Just listen. I know you got some verses and the latest Tim Keller book to share with them, but maybe you just need to listen. Let them talk, because they haven't been able to talk to anybody. They haven't been able to talk to anybody at the church about this stuff. So give an ear and allow them to listen. Be a foot washer that way. God might be calling some of you older pastors to encourage a younger pastor, because you've got experience. You've been through it, and I know I've been the beneficiary of that. Some older pastors have encouraged me, because sometimes as a younger pastor, you get hit, and you're like, what was that? And the older pastor be like, that's just ministry. That's just ministry. And I'm like, oh, okay, that's what that is. And God might be calling some of you younger pastors to encourage an older pastor. And I want to do it a little bit right now. Some of you guys might be older, and there's a lot changing in the world right now. You're like, man, what is happening in this world right now? I'm here to encourage you that you still are the man or the woman for that job. And the times might be changing. And you can get with it. You can adapt. You can adjust. But you still are the man or the woman of that church. You still are the pastor or one of the pastors at that church. You still are an elder or a deacon at that church. And God still has you there. It's not time for you to throw in the towel yet. God might be telling some of you to develop some long-term relationships. God might be calling you to coach someone or mentor someone. That's your way of washing some feet. You might be called to become a financial partner to a church planter. Reply to that email that church planter keeps sending you. Some of you might be called to fill a pulpit. And I'm not fishing for compliments, but some of you need to encourage the speakers. It's not always easy. And I'm a black preacher. I might need an amen every now and then. That's all I'm saying. Just one. Wash some feet this week. And some of us might be called to be the foot washee. Let someone wash your feet. And dear foot washee, you need to let someone encourage you. Some of you just need to make some friends. You don't need to run this race alone. Let someone wash your feet. Some of you need to cry because you hadn't been able to. Let someone be the shoulder that you can cry on this week. Some of you need to tell someone close to you what's really going on in your marriage. Tell them what's really going on. You might need to allow someone to come alongside you and counsel you. I want to point you to a resource that the EPC has here. Cron and Elizabeth Gibson from Hopewell Ministries. They're here. They have a counseling ministry. I'm promoting them right now. They're my counselors. That's who I go to when I get all messed up and mixed up. And that's okay. It's okay to not be okay. They're here for that reason. Cron, Elizabeth, if you're around, can you raise your hand? Yeah, them cool people over there. They've spoken so much life into me, and some of you might need to go spend some time with them, and that's okay. Some of you might need to learn to accept the compliment. I get it. We compliment you, and you're like, oh, brother, I'm just a sinner. Just let us compliment you, man. Just take the compliment. That's your form of getting your feet washed this week. Some of you might need to confess something heavy. And some of you just need to sit and let the word be preached. And you might just need to experience some worship here and just allow yourself to be served. Allow yourself to be vulnerable. Allow your feet to be seen. Allow your feet to be washed. You can be vulnerable before King Jesus. You can take off those shoes. Bunions, corns, and all. He already knows. Let him see them. You can be vulnerable so he can serve you, and let his people serve you and bless you this week. And some of us need to get down on a knee and wash someone else's feet this week. And we can love like that because we've been loved greatly by a great king who first loved us. Isn't that good news? Yeah. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you in your mighty son's Jesus' name. God, I lift up my brothers and sisters here who've been running and walking hard. I pray that they would experience your love and your blessing while they're here. I pray that you would give us thoughtful and creative ways to serve one another. It's in your mighty and matchless son's Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.